that y'all are here with us today. I know a lot of folks are still traveling or out of town with Thanksgiving holidays and stuff, and I think that's where Alan's at today. He asked me to fill in this morning, so I'm glad to do it. We're going to sing Angels We Have Heard on High. So let's all stand together, please, and if you'd like to get your hymn book, it's on hymn number 100, Angels We Have Heard on High.
Let's give our kids a hand. Well, good morning and welcome to Angel Grove Baptist Church. And goodness, I am so excited to see y'all this morning. This is going to be an incredible day. And I just want to tell you that we have been praying and preparing for this day. So if you're our visitor, if you received one of the pamphlets out front, there's a card in the middle of it. If you would please take that card and fill it out. And at the end of the service, my wife and I will both be at the double doors at the exit. And we would love to exchange that card for a gift. And just to tell you, thank you for coming to visit us today. And I just quickly want to mention, we have these flags that these kids brought in. And I'm new to some of these things. I've been part of a flag parade before, but this is the black flag, that is the unreached people groups. And y'all probably all know this. I'm still new to a lot of traditions. And so that is why we're here. We're here for the unreached people groups. But I don't want you to miss this as we get ready for the message of the day. The unreached people group begin right here where we are. It begins in our own congregation, in our own community, and then our own state, and then all the way to the domestic, to the international. We are here to reach people. And so as we get ready today, my prayer is that your heart is open to what God wants to show you. And let's be excited for what God has to do. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for today. God, thank you for allowing us to be here to worship. Lord, to just grow in you. Father, I pray that you touch every one of our hearts. And Lord, I pray that we can worship with joy, God. Thank you for songs. Thank you for praise. And Lord, just get us to the place of true thanksgiving. And so, Lord, I thank you for everything that you're going to do. And I ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And before I run off, I'm going to mention one last thing. This is super important. Tonight, we're going to have our hanging of the green. But at the conclusion of that, we're going to take a few moments and we're going to celebrate the Folsom family. And we're going to have some finger foods afterwards, so I ask that everybody please make it a point to be here tonight to celebrate them as God has called them to another area of ministry, and we want to send them off and tell them truly how much we appreciate everything that they've done and how much they've invested in this church. And so without further ado, let's get back to worship.
Let's all stand together again, please, and if you want to turn in your hymn book, it's hymn number 87. We're going to sing one verse of Joy to the World, and then I want you to just go around, welcome one another, fellowship a little bit, and then we'll come back in and sing the second and last stanzas. Joy to the World, hymn number 87. remain standing, please. We're going to sing hymn number 91, first, second, and last stanzas of Silent Night. Hymn number 91, and it'll also be up on the screen. Hymn number 91.
Thanksgiving season, Father. And Father, we want to remember all those that's been mentioned that sick in body. I pray that you'll be with them. We know you're the great physician, and I pray that you'll be in that situation, Father. And Father, to take up collection, I pray that we'll use it for upbuilding of thy kingdom. For I ask it in your name, Jesus.
I'm going to sing a version of Amazing Grace, and I want this to be a congregation song. I'm going to sing it, but I want y'all to sing with me. It's Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. So, but y'all, I'm sure most of you probably know this particular arrangement, so you sing it with me, okay? Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My free, my God, my Savior. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. Sing that again. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine.
listening to that song, Great Is Thy Thankfulness, just thinking about it a little bit this morning, my wife, when y'all see her up front, you might see her writing when I'm preaching. And no, she's not doing the grocery list, even though we're so busy that she probably needs to be. She's taking notes on what she gets out of the message. And today, as she was putting her headers on there and writing down a couple of things, I looked over and I saw my name underneath it. And I tell you something, it absolutely blows my mind that God is using me. And I'm beyond excited to be able to stand here and to know that God is at work in my life and that God has placed us in this very moment for Him to use me in front of you today. And I just remember when I was first saved going to church and I started taking notes and writing my pastor's name up there and every visiting pastor. It's just such an honor to be here. And my thankfulness is overflowing in this very moment. And this excitement that I have, I pray that it never subsides. And I pray for every single person in this congregation today that the excitement that God has put inside of you, that fire that He's put inside of you, that it is never, ever quenched. That you can enjoy and walk in the same excitement that I have, because that's what He's created you for. And so today, we're going to be starting a new series. And then we're going to be in Acts 1:8. We're going to be doing it for a few weeks. And it's going to have some different parts to it. And we'll get to that in just a moment. And so it's going to be a little bit different. I'm not going to have you stand for the reading today, because we're going to be going over it time and time again. So we're not going to stand up. But the verse today is Acts 1:8. And I'm going to read it. And then we'll start breaking it down. And then we'll get into the beginning of the service. So the verse today, though, Acts 1:8 is, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." There's a lot in this. So prepare. Just get prepared for what God has. Let's bow our heads and go to Him in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for your word. God, thank you for the spoken word of Jesus. Thank you for allowing us to be able to dig into it in your Bible, Lord. And I just pray right now that you use your word, your touch, your spirit to move every single one of us. God, I pray that you open our eyes to exactly what you want us to see. And Father, I pray that we can leave being the Acts 1:8 church that you have saved us and put us together to be. Father, I know that there's people in here that need you today. Lord, I don't know what their circumstances are, but you do. And I pray that you use your word to touch them, to empower them, to strengthen them, to have confidence and courage in you in every way. And Lord, give us the assurance without any shadow of doubt that we belong to you. And touch that one that doesn't have it today. And I pray that they surrender their life to you. Lord, thank you so much for everything that you're going to do. Come in power in this place and ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So the Acts 1:8 church, I kind of want to go to something really fast before I get into this. When we sung Amazing Grace just a minute ago, "And like a flood, His mercy reigns." I can't get that out of my head this morning. Thank you so much for that, Daniel. That word touched my heart. And as we go through the message, we're going to be talking about the Holy Spirit today. We're going to be focused on Him. But when we get into the depth of the Holy Spirit and what He wants to do in us, that flood that we sung of, I just want everybody to put that in your mind, set that to memory, and be ready to bring it back up in just a few minutes, because that will drive home what the Holy Spirit wants to do in you. And so this three-part series that we're going to be looking at, it's going to begin with, and I've got these fancy slides, if y'all hadn't caught on yet, that I made. I'm a little stepping out of my own zone doing these things. But in part one today, it's going to be, "But you shall receive." And so we're going to be focused on the Holy Spirit. And then as we go forward next week, we're going to be looking at what is a witness. This verse calls us all to be witnesses. So what is that? How do we become one? How do we do that? And then we'll wrap up in the third week, and it's going to be, where do we go? And I think it is so fitting that we have the flags out here, and God's just charging us with what He wants us to do and what He wants us to be and what He has put us together for. And so as we work through every one of these, the thing that really God has impressed on my heart is that we are to be part of a living church. We're not just here to congregate and to hang out and to wait for heaven. We have a purpose. If that wasn't the case, the moment we were saved, God would take us from earth and bring us to heaven, and that would be it. But that's not our purpose. It is so much greater, and it is all encompassed in this verse. You think about it. When you think about a living organism, they have purpose. They live, they mature, they reproduce, they die, but the species continues because they have continued to pour into more and more and more and grow. The church is no different. We have purpose. We must continue to reproduce what has been put in us. We don't have to create it. God does the work, but we have to be willing to walk that mile to get there. And so the church has been missing that because we're walking without power. You know, you look across the landscape. I mention this very often. If you look across the landscape and you look at churches as you're driving up, or you can just look at so many. They're closing their doors left and right. They're dying. And the reason being is because somewhere or another, somebody has missed the purpose of the church. And so I don't want to see that happen. You know, you look at church attendance and baptisms. I pulled the numbers last night, and we can blame COVID for so many things over the last couple of years, but the numbers don't lie. We're out of COVID now. People are back at church, but the numbers are still dwindling. Why is that? Why is that? Something's going wrong somewhere, because the gospel is no different than it was 2,000 years ago as it is today. Nothing has changed. You can even look at the numbers within our own congregation. The numbers have slowly declined over the last few years. I say over the last few years, since the 90s. Why has that happened? Something somewhere along the line, we're damming the flow of the Spirit. We're damming it up and keeping it from going to exactly where it belongs. And so as we get into this, I want you to think, what do you need to do? What is your personal responsibility in continuing the flow of the gospel to getting it to where it belongs? Is there something that you personally need to do? And let's look at a fundamental charge of the church and the individual believer and see if that we can turn the ship, if we can ride it, if we can turn the tide, right the ship. And so today, to do that, I'm going to have 3 points that are going to be illuminated in these verses. And the first of these is, but you shall receive. And the first point is the promise of the Holy Spirit. And so in the promise of the Holy Spirit, if we look, it says Jesus, in this verse, he said, Jesus said, you shall receive power. There's not a lot of places in the Bible that you're going to find that Jesus says, you shall. Now, there's some things that happen here, there, and if you go back to the Old Testament and some of the commandments, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. But most of it is you shall not, you shall not, you shall not. But when it comes to Jesus walking and talking on earth, very few times did he say, you shall. But in this very moment, he said that not once but twice in this verse. He said, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me. If Jesus says you shall, it is probably very important that we embrace these words. Because if it is something he says that you shall do, that is the mark of somebody that belongs to him. And if you lack the things that he says that you shall have, then you are lacking him. That's the point that the church has got to grab hold of today. And so, how many promises, let me ask this question, how many promises can you think of that Jesus has not fulfilled? And this is one of them. We have the Holy Spirit when we have him. And so in John chapter 14, verses 16 through 17, Jesus said, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. So inside this promise, the promise of the Holy Spirit, Jesus made the promise for a helper. There's a reason he called it a helper. The reason he called the Holy Spirit a helper, and that's because we're not expected to do this alone. He didn't send us to just navigate life without any assistance. He sent the Holy Spirit so that we can live life and live it abundantly through him. He didn't say, I want you to go be my witness and tell people about me because you should have everything. He said, I'm going to send my helper to make sure that you can do these things. I'm going to give you everything that you need. The promise was for a certain group. If you notice inside that scripture, it says the world could not receive him. Why could the world not receive him? Because they didn't have Jesus. We've got to make room in our heart for the Holy Spirit, or he'll never be able to indwell within us. As long as we are still stuffed full of sin and stuffed full of the things of this world, he cannot enter us. But the moment that we surrender to him, the moment that we turn our life over to him, and that is Jesus, the Holy Spirit indwells within us. Jesus makes the room and fills us with all of our needs. Next, the promise would not be recognized by the world. I'm sorry, I'm getting ahead for y'all. But the promise would not be recognized by the world. But the promise would not be recognized by the world because they don't know him. I think about people that I meet. I can carry on a conversation with somebody that I've never met before, but I don't know them. It's a superficial conversation. But as I grow to know them, I can have a long, enduring conversation with them, and it's personal. And it's the same with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. We don't know him until we have truly surrendered to them and been personal. The Holy Spirit, if you continue to walk in your ways, will never be able to work through you in the way that he was sent to work through you. And the promise should be familiar with believers. I think I kind of jumped ahead there. But he should be familiar. You should be intimately knowing the promise that God has sent, and that is the Holy Spirit. So not only in this should we receive the promise of the Holy Spirit, we should also receive the purpose of the Holy Spirit. In John 16:13-15, Jesus says, "However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore, I said that he will take of mine and declare it to you." He will guide you in all truth. You know, you think about taking a car, and I'll go back to my very first traffic accident, if that'll help you relate to this a little bit. But think about driving a car, and you're heading down the road, and as you're going down through there, you drift one way or the other, and all of a sudden you realize that you're in big trouble. What's the worst thing that you do when you get out of your lane or do something you shouldn't do? Everybody wants to overcorrect and snatch the wheel and pull it one way, way too hard. That's our natural reaction. We jump at whatever that problem is. We panic. And so what happens? I'm drifting one way. I yank the steering wheel the other. And then I fishtail, and then the rest is history. I'm lucky that my parents were willing to fix my truck for me back then. That's about where it ended. But with all of that being said, and I only had my license for about a month when I did that. But the Spirit is here to guide us. He's to keep us from overcorrecting where we go wrong. We don't have to panic when we make mistakes. We don't have to continue in our mistakes because we've stepped into them. He's here to guide us and keep us right where we belong. He wants to keep us in the lane that God created, that he made. He's our guide. That is his purpose. He will never fail. He will speak the truth. The Spirit is here to speak the truth. He's not going to tell you something that you're not. The Spirit's not going to put you somewhere that you shouldn't be. He's going to tell you exactly who you are. He's going to remind you who you belong to. So when you get in those places where Satan has grabbed a hold of you and you just feel like there's nothing that you can ever do, listen to the Spirit. He's going to bring you right back to where you belong. He's going to tell you the truth that you are God's, that you've been redeemed, that you have purpose, and he has given it to you. He will guide you to glory. And this is the amazing part. No matter how messed up that we've been, and I'm going to tell you, I was messed up. But God saved me, redeemed me, restored me, and made me so much more than I ever could have been without him. We shared in Sunday school today about a time that I had sin in my life right after I got saved, and I refused to let it go because I thought that was the only way that I could find joy is by continuing in this sin. And God, he pulled at me and tugged at me and told me through the Spirit time and time again, get rid of this, get rid of this, get rid of this. And then finally one day, he got my attention and said, "God, I'm done. Take it from me. It's yours." But I said this, I said, "God, you're going to have to show me how to find joy. You're going to have to show me how I don't have to have this anymore, but I can fill it with you. I surrender it, but God, help me. I need you." And what did he do? He showed me how, as I mentioned a while ago, not only to live life, but he showed me how to live life abundantly in him. And I didn't need it anymore. I didn't need what I thought was satisfaction. He gave me joy. And so he'll lead us to glory. He serves to bring God glory. That is the Spirit's purpose. And so he will always lead you there. He will set you apart from the world. Look around. I ask everybody in here to reflect for just 1 minute. If you were to take your life and put it up against anybody that you know, is there something different about you? Think about it for just a minute. Does your life look like everyone else's? If that's the case, you are missing out. You are missing out on the Holy Spirit, because there is no way the promise that has purpose, that lives within us, will leave us where we used to be, or will leave us just like the rest of the world. He's going to set you apart. You are going to be different. And I have lived so much of my life walking around the church as a lost man, looking at the lives of those that claim to have Jesus. And don't ever do this. Don't compare your life to the people inside the church. But I was doing it. I was comparing my life to those in the church, and I didn't see a difference. Matter of fact, I saw where I was better off than them in so many ways. And so there's a lot of failures in that. But the thing is us as believers, we should be different. We should be different. We should not look like the same people that are walking in and out of these stores on Saturday nights that can't get up in time to be at church on Sunday because of what they did on Saturday night. We shouldn't look like the lost. I think that's the easiest way to put it. If you have Jesus in you, you should not look like everyone else. Christians wouldn't be doing the same thing if they truly had Jesus, if they had the power of the Holy Spirit living within them. And I'm going to throw this one at you. The orphanages would not have a single child within them. The DHR would not be looking for foster parents. Lou would be without a job just about it if Christians were full of the Holy Spirit and lived like it. The Holy Spirit is so much more than every one of us give him credit for. Let's stop stomping out the power that's in him. And I'm getting, yes, stop stomping out the power that's in him and let him live in you and just get saved. That's what the call is. Let's get saved. Let's quit living like the world and let's live for Jesus. Let's surrender our lives. But not only should you receive power through the promise and through the purpose, but you should also receive, and you should receive the power of the Holy Spirit. The power, it cannot be stopped. It's just what I'm talking about. In John 7, 37 through 39, it says, on the last day, the great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, if anyone thirst, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given because Jesus was not yet glorified. Let me tell you something. Jesus has been glorified and the Spirit has been given. Do you have him? Do you have him? What does it take? Going back into the scripture and from what I mentioned earlier, what does it take to stop a river? We can do all kinds of things to slow them down. We can put a dam in place. And we can make really big rivers and lakes. But it's going to continue to flow. Eventually, the floodgates are going to have to be open. The turbines are going to have to be turned on. That water is going to come out of that dam one way or the other. If it don't, it's going to overflow it. And if we go back to this scripture, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Not just water, but living water. If you have that water inside of you, it should be flowing out. You should not be able to stop it. You should not be able to go, you shouldn't be able to go your life without telling people about Jesus. You should be speaking Jesus in the way that you walk, in the way that you talk, in the way that you live. Jesus should be flowing out of you by way of the Holy Spirit. So we can make excuses. We can say that I've backslidden, that I've gotten in some trouble, I've just gotten in a low spot, I've stumbled. We can make excuses for it. And there are temporary excuses. Things happen. But there is no long-term way that you can stop the flow of water that is inside of you if it's living. There is no possible way. And that's what happened to me the day that I got saved. There was living water placed inside of me, and no one, and I mean no one, can stop it. And that is the life that God has created you for. Here's the ultimate point in it all. The reason that the water stops flowing is because you never had it in the first place. And we can never be an Acts 1:8 church. We can never be an Acts 1:8 people without having the first things first, and that is Jesus. So the sticking point is this. Many people hang their hat on the good things and the good deeds in their life. They say, I've done this and I've done that, or I haven't done this and I have. We have all of these different things that we hang our hat on. But it comes down to this. Do you have Jesus? Because if you have Jesus, you have the Holy Spirit. And all of this that I've talked about today just falls into place. But I also know that many within the church hang their hat on a moral right that's in their life. And so I have some great experience. I have some great experience about being morally right. I've had a job my whole life. I've provided for my family my whole life. I've given money my whole life. I've taken care of the needy my whole life. If somebody needed something, I was there for it. And the great thing is, God has placed a moral compass inside every one of us for that very purpose. And I will venture out to say, and I'm going to read scripture here in just a second to show you this, but I would venture to say that from the time that I was born till the time that I was saved, that God had put a moral compass in me to preserve me for today, so that I could stand here and share this message with you. And I say that because of this. God had a purpose in me, and he wanted to protect me from the things that I could do wrong. I praise God that he preserved me. But the thing is, most people confuse this moral compass with the Holy Spirit. And if you look at this last slide right now, it says there is confusion, the Holy Spirit or the conscience. So many people, we just read all of this scripture and all of this preaching that I just went through on what the Holy Spirit is. But I'm going to talk to you for just a couple of seconds before we conclude today about what the Holy Spirit is not. And I need everybody in here to grasp this, because this church is going to be a true Acts 1:8 church. And for us to do that, we have got to know the difference. We have got to be able to understand that the conscience is not the Holy Spirit. And so in Romans 2:15, and I'm going to read the New Living Translation because it just paints this picture so perfectly clear. It says, they demonstrate that God's law is written in their hearts, for their own conscience and thoughts either accuse them or tell them they are doing right. So in this verse, the conscience is something that is given to everyone. In this, Paul is explaining that the Gentiles, that they knew right from wrong. They knew right from wrong, but they did not have Jesus in this. The Gentiles had not gotten him yet. It says they were accused of doing right or wrong, but that was it. So the things that were morally wrong felt wrong to them. But the conscience's purpose is to preserve us to salvation. I'm going to read a quote to you from Sam Horn. And he said, the conscience is an inner human faculty corrupted by sin and the fall. And the Holy Spirit is the divine agent God uses to bring his redemptive work in a believer. The Spirit takes someone who is dead in sin and darkened in their understanding to someone who has life and the eyes of their heart enlightened. I don't think I could say it any more eloquently. The conscience is simply corrupted but made to preserve. The Holy Spirit is redemptive. And he takes us from death to life. And so the conscience's purpose is to preserve us to salvation. In 1 Timothy 4, 1-3, it says, now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. In verse 2, it says, these people are hypocrites and liars, and their consciences are dead. So this is why this message is so imperative. This is where it all comes home. We have to have the Holy Spirit. When the gospel is presented, there comes a time when our conscience is not going to bring us to where it belongs anymore. We're going to eventually have dead consciences. That is coming. That's what that verse tells us, and I've seen people that have been completely given over to the life of depravity. Yes, and they can no longer receive Jesus because their time has passed. Don't confuse the work of your conscience that's telling you that something's wrong for the redemptive qualities and the power that comes from the Holy Spirit. Just because you've done good in your life does not mean you've got the Holy Spirit. It just means that God is trying to hold you over until the day that you can be saved. And He has purpose in it all. Throughout this scripture, if we look at it, if we break it down from the very beginning, we have promise, we have purpose, and we have power. We have power not to be the same as we ever were. And if you're the same, today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of salvation. Do not let that flow of water stop with you. It doesn't matter what your mama did. It doesn't matter what your daddy did. It doesn't matter if you taught Sunday school. It doesn't matter if you're a deacon. It doesn't matter if you've preached a word before, spoken at a men's breakfast, been part of the women's missionary group, traveled overseas and told people about Jesus. None of those things matter if you don't have Jesus. And through this scripture, there's no way that anybody in this room cannot go back and reflect and see if there's not been a moment of change in their life. Have you had that moment? The scripture tells us in 1 John 5:13, these things are written so that you may know that you have eternal life. We're not made to be confused. We're made to have certain knowledge that Jesus is our Savior. And God sent Him so that He can be your Savior. If you don't know Him, understand that we are all sinners and that we all fall short of the glory of God. We all are. And there's not one thing that we can do about it. God created heaven as a place for us to go and spend eternity with Him. But sin blocks us from there. There's no way that we can make it. But God sent Jesus to redeem us. He lived that perfect life that we couldn't live. And beyond that, He sacrificed His perfect life. He was buried in a tomb and rose on the third day to prove everything that He said was fact and could not be disputed. I believe that all my life. I believe that since I could understand just the most minute things of life. When I knew my ABCs, I knew that Jesus came and gave His life for me. But you know what? We are so filled with head knowledge that we can't see what true surrender is. Church, I need you in surrender so that God can use us to do exactly what He wants to do with us. We can't do this with just part of the church. I need the whole church on board. We're going to be an Acts 1-8 church together. And it begins with the surrender. James 2:19 says, you believe in one God, and I'm paraphrasing, he says, that's great. But even the demons believe and tremble. Do not think that just knowing the gospel means that you have it. So today the invitation is this. Surrender your life to Jesus and have the power of the Holy Spirit living in you. Understand that your life, you were created for something so much greater than you have ever experienced if you've never walked in His ways. It's not something that you've got to do on your own. It's something that He wants to do through you. And I'm going to tell you, there's no greater time than right now than to surrender your life to Jesus. So the invitation is, if you need Jesus, please come and grab me by the hand. We're going to do things a little bit differently today. So if everybody will just stand with me for a second. We're going to have just some instrumental music playing. We're not going to sing. And I want everybody to bow your head and close your eyes for just a moment. And I just want you to reflect inside your heart right now and ask God, God, do I truly have your Spirit living within me? Do I have you? Have you set me apart, or am I like everybody else in my life? Have I lived by your power or my own? God, it doesn't matter how old we are, how young we are, It doesn't matter what we've done. Just show me, am I yours? Just ask him that. Father, I love you. God, thank you for your spirit and your power. God, I pray that you inundate this church right now. Lord, touch every heart. Show them exactly who they belong to. Is their name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? God, if it's not, today is the day of salvation. And Father, I pray for salvation so that we can fulfill your call on our life, God. There is so much more to what you created us for than we even begin to know. But right now, I just want us to truly experience it. Father, reveal yourself in this place. Lord, with every head bowed and every eye closed, I know that sometimes we can feel embarrassment when Jesus is working on us, when the Holy Spirit has touched our hearts. Some people can feel embarrassed. You don't have anything to be embarrassed about, but I'm going to ask you this. If you know that you need Jesus today, if you need salvation from your sin, from the very thing that has separated you from a holy God, I ask that you just raise your hand and you hold it up. If you just raise your hand where I can see it, I would love to lead you to Jesus. He'll do all the work. All you have to do is surrender. And there is a whole new life for you. If you need that, just raise your hand. Nobody's looking. You don't have to be embarrassed. You can just have confidence in Him. Okay, church, I can see the response. If y'all look at me for just a second. I've seen the response of the church. Y'all have heard the charge of God's word today. We are claiming to be spirit-filled people. If you are lacking that in any way, today is the day to repent. God has big plans, plans that I can't even see right now. And he wants to use every one of you in those ways, in ways that we couldn't imagine. He wants to empower us to touch the world. This altar, it is time that we come to him and we lay down everything that we have and say, give me everything that you want. Use me. Show me what I need to get out of the way in my life so that you can use me to reach people. There's way too many open seats in here today for him to be using us the way that we all should be used. Let's go and let God. I'm going to pray one more time, and then the altar is absolutely open. If you're visiting here and you don't have a church home, and God's calling you to a place where you can serve him and worship him and love him and go tell others about him, you're at the right place. If you need to join the church today, come grab me by the hand. I'd love to talk to you about that. And there's still time. If you need Jesus, we're not guaranteed another second, but you have this moment. Father, I love you. Lord, I pray that you will just move and let your people stir. Lord, I pray for a time of celebration, thanksgiving, repentance, renewal at the altar right now. Father, thank you for everything that you're going to do. I love you and praise you and ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If you will come. Let's give God a hand. All right. Well, I know I mentioned this earlier, but please do not forget this evening. Hang into the green. I know it's going to be a very special time. And then not only do we get to celebrate Jesus in that moment, then we get to celebrate Joe and his family as they get ready to head on the next step that God has for them. Thank you all. And my wife and I will be at the back of the room, and we'll turn it over to Jaden.
Just being with us, God, I pray that if anyone doesn't know you, God, they'll just come to you, God. And, Lord, I just pray for safe health, God, safe travels, God, and I thank you for everything you do, God. In Jesus' name, amen.